Welcome back, everybody, to the We Play Dota 2 match between Evil Geniuses and Oryx. We're here in the winner bracket. Both these two teams winning their first round match, and the winner of this match will win the group. As you guys can see, the brackets are up there. We're going to hop ourselves into the draft, as it is EG, the Americans, up against the Ukrainian squad with a few known names and faces, Dubas, as well as Tony Montana. Who we saw carry them to victory in their first match over up against Team Dust. EG took down the slightly tougher Arctic, but we'll see how EG fare up against Auroch, who are probably the, on paper, the best team in this group after EG. So we'll see how things go. Joining me is, of course, Vikramont, and we've got ourselves at least two, well, we've got ourselves two more best of ones, this one as well as the final second place deciding match. So EG still looking like they're sort of in position to take this group.
Absolutely. I got to quickly just give a shout out to the format. We play agreeing. I think it was you guys who actually proposed the GSL style format.
Yeah.
And I think everything should be like this. Every time you have a group stage, every game actually is consequential. It has some sort of meaning. You don't have games that are useless. And so you sort of, I don't know, it sets up little storylines that I think are good. And you get to follow the same teams throughout a day. So Aurochs, I like the Magnus, I got to say, because we just saw Tony Montana play an absolutely excellent Magnus in the last game. And if something's working for you in like a one-day event like this, stick with what works. It's sort of the same thing when you go to like a chess tournament or something. You should play the openings you've studied, not the openings that you sort of just think are good. The flip side of this is I know that the last time these two teams played in the Iso Cup, Aurochs were pulling out all sorts of weird pocket picks, but I would look for those in the second pick phase. We have seen them pull out things like a PA, Zeus, Enchantress, and if those happen, they'll be happening late. But for now, just both teams picking up very solid overall lineups.
Solid overall lineups, but EG do sort of reveal a thing or two. They get the Clockwork as well. They get essentially three Solar Heroes. And I think to me, this looks like we're going to see a Batrider jungle. I think having Puck, Clockwork, and Batrider, you don't really have any actual major semi-carry or carry. You need something at least like a Queen of Pain as your main carry. Ideally, you want something with a bit more DPS than that. So I think we see Batrider go to the jungle. And then we see Puck in the mid lane, Clockwork in the off lane, or maybe some kind of a weird tri lane. But they definitely need some kind of a solo here, or some kind of a carry.
I wouldn't be shocked, Gods, to see them do something like a Clockwork-based tri lane. Just because it puts Batrider in a tough position, although they can just have the Batrider jungle, zero in the solo hard, and then a tri lane. The reason I say this might happen, and they might just go without a carry, is if you're a team that thinks you're a lot better, like if you actually have a major skill advantage, it's kind of to your advantage to play very aggressively because you can just win on individual skill and you don't have to worry about a potentially random late game. The standard thing for EG, I think, would be to give Demon something a little more, give him a little more punch. But on the other hand, we've seen Demon play Clockwork. Why not play Clockwork in a tri lane?
Yeah, it's one of the, we could even see a support Clockwork in a tri lane, I feel wouldn't be all that bad, something I think a teams have done here and there. We're going to see a Venomancer, probably not a Malk Venomancer, unfortunately, for those of you hoping for that, but Malk's switched over to the solo roles, he's upgraded, he's said, I've had enough feeding with supports, I want to feed with, what's the best role to be in if you want to be a feeder? It's the suicide lane, that's the role he's now playing, although his lone druid did absolutely fantastic. This is not digging into Malk. The role itself is sort of most prone to dying.
There is a reason it's called the suicide lane. I agree. Yeah. So, Gods, you think he's just angling for more awards? He's just pretending he doesn't like the award. He wants more of them.
I think there's definitely something fishy going on.
I honestly, I like that EG are experimenting.
Yeah.
After you take a long break, like, it can be hard to sort of get yourself back into the same form, back in the same excitement about the game, and freshening yourself up a bit, trying different roles, seeing, you know, who knows, maybe it'll work. I mean, I don't know if you've been watching the VG1 games at all, but they just seem so much more reinvigorated, not just because they added ZSMJ, but just the rotation of CTY to the middle. Just all of a sudden, they're like a completely different and new team, even with four of the same five players. And I think EG might be angling for some of that. Like, get a little bit of that love of the game back in, get maybe try out some people in roles that they're not as familiar with, but that they can really grow into.
I think the other big thing for EG is having Fear on support, because he's drafting as well as being the captain here. He's going to get his team respected. But I think the big thing with Fear playing support is that as a captain, it's a lot easier to do that from a support position. Doing that from a carry position is a lot harder. And with Malk, who used to sort of it's been feared drafting and captain for a while, but Malk definitely back when before he took this holiday was taking a lot of sort of the in-game decision making. So I think now that he's come back from holiday, Field probably feels even more pressure on himself to make the in-game decision. So he says, "Okay, I'll do that from a support role, Malk. You handle this offlane role," which is a role where he can just focus on his own play. He doesn't have to make calls.
Yeah, absolutely. That's actually a really, really great insight, because I do agree that I think even before they were sort of grooming Fear to take over that major like captaincy role, and this sort of break with Melk coming back actually gives them the opportunity to really solidify that. But right now, we actually don't see Fear, unless this is a support Batrider, we don't see him on the support. We do see him on the bat.
I think it's jungle Batrider.
Yeah, almost certainly, I think. So that means my issue here with this lineup is B-Diz and Demon. If Aurochs put a lot of pressure on this, Venno and Spectre can kind of fold early unless they get a lot of help from the other lanes.
They could, but it's going to be a safe lane trial lane coming out from Aurochs. It's Antimage to the bottom lane. We'll introduce the Ukrainian team Aurochs. Antimage being played by Seymour, who played an insanely farm Luna the other day. We've got Dubas on the Duke Hero. Well, the other day, I mean today. It's late here. It's like, what's the time? I'm tabbing out quickly. 11 a.m. and I don't
know. Ouch.
I've been awake for a while now, I guess. I don't know. It all blurs together.
No worries. I'm just busting.
Tossy on the Shadow Demon. Tony Montana on the Magnus once again, and CA on the Darkseer. I feel like this is very similar to their last game.
Yeah, very, very similar lineup, just with an anti-mage swapped in for the Luna. The question is it a 3.5-minute Midas anti-mage? Looking up towards EG, their tri-lane, well, they don't actually have a traditional tri-lane, but their dual lane will be composed of Demon on the Spectre, he's quoting some Drake lyrics in his name here, then B-Diz will be supporting up on the Venomancer. We do have Fear taking up the jungle on the Batrider, and he's on fire because he's Batrider, that's funny. And then the middle will be played by, I assume this is J.O., this has got to be J.O., on the puck, and finally Melk taking up the solo role once again, with this time with the clockwork.
Yeah, he's going to be up against the trail, and this is not going to be easy for him to get much XP, but he's already managed to sort of ruin... This is what Seymour was trying to do with the Luna, up against the clockwork. I think this is sort of what the trick is. He goes up to tank the creep wave a bit because he wants to make sure all four creeps arrive at the same time. That's what the clockwork cog messes up. If two creeps arrive and then the other two come later, you lose the creep equilibrium. So by taking the creep wave a bit, he maintains the creep equilibrium.
Huh. That's a good point. I wonder if this is something we'll see more teams do, actually, because I haven't seen it that often, Gods, and I don't think many teams are doing this yet, but it actually is pretty promising, because if you're not in danger as the carry, it's not that bad to tank this creep wave to get the positioning right.
Yeah, and he's doing some even more tanking now. He gets himself a poor man shield, but we're going to see some early pulls come out from the Radiant team support, and as a result, Antimage is going to be forced to last hit either under his tower or just tank creep waves and last hit outside of his tower, which he's okay with, especially with a poor man shield, some tangos there. His supports can always pull him some more. And right now, bottom lane, I imagine we just see Clockwork being zoned out as much as possible, which they've done a good job of. Mid lane, Puck versus Mag, somewhat relatively even matchup. We'll have to see how things go
there.
They're
going in on Malk.
Oh man, Malk, has he actually been caught out? The one thing you can't afford to do, and that Cogs is not going to help him. He can't get out. First blood, supports should be... I think supports will get it. Shadow Demon!
Oh no!
He had another right click. Maybe he could have salved it and survived, but he doesn't even cancel the salve.
Ooh. I think that was a pretty serious mistake. They could have... How confident do you feel if you're Aurochs and you get that kill? Because it's like, wow, we're just playing the exact same game, but on repeat. But now if you don't get it and Melk actually maintains pretty full life, you're like, oh, this might not be as easy as
they tried
game.
Too hard to give the kill to Antimage, which is a mistake there. Mag going to find a regen room, but it's going to come at the cost of his own life. J.O. dodges the shockwave, gets the kill with the orb, and it was the rotation from B-Diz that helped secure it.
B-Diz is quietly just, he produces so much for EG every game. I mean, obviously we all remember DreamHack Winter, where he just was incredible, really, really just almost carrying them from the support role, and just always smart rotations from him. And I feel like even Milk, even though as strong of a support as he was, I think one thing EG has not had is this amazing sort of dual support working with each other so far. And I think that may be part of the reason why they're sort of trying these different experimental support approaches, is to try to get that sort of, get somebody who really, like, syncs up extremely well with B-Diz.
Well, Demon at the top lane's had complete free farm. We'll have to see. This isn't really a game, I guess, so much for syncing up when you've got a Batrider, but we're seeing B-Diz stack, well, he's stacking neutrals for Fear. Fear going to have to head back to base to heal himself up. What is, he's got himself a bottle? No, just boots for the time being. So we're going to see boots and probably a rush blink dagger, so... B-Diz stacks his neutrals, and then Fear's going to clear him out because Demon doesn't need any support at top lane. Darkseer's abandoned top lane. just to go straight jungle. So it's like you say, almost identical play to the last game coming out from Aurochs.
Hmm. And actually, interestingly, EG are playing basically the dust roll as well so far, with both with Fear, obviously not playing a hard support character, but Fear and Bidez focusing 100% of their time on the jungle while the carry solo farms the safe lane. And meanwhile, Aurochs just sort of trying to put infinite pressure, as much pressure as they can, on the solo lane, while also trying to get their supports a few levels.
Yeah, and it's EG who are going to have that experience advantage because of the way the Batrider can just flash farm so fast in the jungle. It's sort of, it's actually dipped back up a bit, but that's because Fierce has just been healing up. But that's going to quickly go back heavily in EG's favor once he kills off this big stack. And well,
Fear is the big wild card. It's a much more offensive, I keep saying support because he's in a support role basically, but it's a much more aggressive positioning than the Nyx Cuddle that we saw coming out from Dust. And I think that might upend the balance, because having Batrider, who's going to get extremely quick levels due to the dual jungle stacking, means that they have a tool to really put pressure on that carry. Like, you're not going to be going 3.5 minutes safe Midas. And in fact, he will go fast Battle Fury.
I think, you know, they may have failed to get the first spot on Malk, which was a big mistake and hurt them a lot, but Malk's still level 1 compared to a Darkseer who's level 5. This is a big, big win in that regard for Aurochs. Mm-hmm. Sure, you've got Batrider who's getting sort of equal levels and farm over in the Dire Jungle and is a much more wildcard hero. Darkseer, he gets his levels, he gets his mech, he comes to team fights, whereas Batrider, he can sort of be a bit of a playmaker. But I still feel that Malk being this underleveled is a big concern for EG.
I certainly agree. The tough thing is, where is he going to go to really find any sort of farm? I mean, Demon, this entire top half of the map is accounted for, right? Like, this jungle is being completely... The efficiency of EG farming this jungle is near 100%. Like, they are depleting... They're basically mountaintop removal from farming this jungle. And, of course, Demon has this lane unlock, which leaves mid. But Jayo is going to want the farm in mid, and so where does Milk go? I guess he, like, stacks Ancients and hopes somebody comes to give him XP.
And that's his top lane as soon as it reaches his tower. Demon's going for something a bit cute. We're going to see a Midas on him.
Ooh, all right. Not 3.5 minutes, but, you know, not every Midas can come in 3 minutes.
This is your more standard Midas time, 5 to 5.5 minutes. And, well, he's got that up now and going to be looking just to basically farm for a late game. It's got a funny little cute implementation against Darkseer. You can use it, well, whenever it's up on the Iron Shield creep, just to sort of not have to be worried so much about it. But that's only every...
That's true.
What, every 100 seconds or so you can do seconds, that. But he did that right off the bat, but it just helps a bit with that harass.
It helps a bit, but you don't want to hold your cooldown back for that. We're not talking a Chen or Enchantress where the Midas is actually suddenly not a gold-producing item. It's destroying the other jungler. Actually, Melk gets... No, they don't have anything to follow up on this. What do you think about the Midas strategically, Gods? Do you think it's the right call, or do you think it's a little overly cute?
I don't think it's necessary. I don't think it's bad, but I just don't think it's needed this game. I think you can just go... the times I've seen Spectre get played by Loda and as well as by AUI 2000, I've never seen a Midas get picked up. It's always been sort of a more tank up as fast as possible. Sometimes not even going for the fast radiance. It'll be like a Manta style build coming out. And I think this Midas it's not something which is going to hurt him. I think he's.
Sure.
Ultimately, he's had this free farm lane. Why not get a Midas? But.
True.
I think it's just a personal preference for him.
Right. No, I think I agree with you. My point just goes back to the fact that if you're the dominant favorite, I don't think it necessarily is that great to play super safe. I think EG know that if they sort of just go in after they get their levels and initial farm, that they're most likely advantaged in these team fights solely by virtue of playing together as a team more, perhaps having the players that have sort of been in the pro scene a little longer. Aurochs do have 2 veterans, but, I mean, not all of them have sort of been in the pro scene for that long. I feel like... Something like just a fast Diffusal or what have you, or even fast Manta, would just put Spectre in a position where even though she's a hard carry, they could just sort of dominate the game from there. Not that Midas is bad. I mean, he'll get levels over Anti-Mage, definitely.
Yeah, it's like you say, there's 2 ways to play this. Spectre get more involved, start coming to some early ganks. You've already got level 8, so you can see some Haunts, Desolate, spectral Daggers around the map. But I think he decides where the opening's coming. Bottom lane, not really. Because Malk's level 1, he's not going to be taking part in any kills. The only hero you can gank with is the Puck.
Yeah, I mean, poor Malk. Do you see his XP per minute? I don't think it'll ever hit 0, but...
I'm looking at hero levels. Where's XP per minute?
R.
Oh my gosh. Oh, Malk.
He has 4. That's almost more depressing than 0. Because when it's 0, you're like, oh, he hasn't gotten any XP. Yeah. But when it's 4...
It's... one creep worth of
XP. Oh, Jaya's gonna get Tony Montana.
Oh, wow. That's a nice little kill there. Demon actually helps out a bit with that ulti. Doesn't come in for any golden XP, but it's more just helping out Geo, making sure he gets a kill. And this is the one player for EG who can be making plays here while Demon is just off farming. It's going to be Geo, because Malk, as we've said, nothing happening there. They've got Fear. How's Fear doing? He's Blink Dagger soon? Okay. 1900 gold. We'll see that Blink Dagger up, and then he can get more active as well. I imagine we may even see another attempted kill on Mag. Slow down his Blink Dagger even more.
Once Fear has Blink, I don't know that Tony Montana can even return to this middle lane. It just becomes a free fire zone for EG's two blinking heroes.
Man, Malk is so persistent in this offlane. Cogging some more creeps. Slowing up this equilibrium as much as possible. At this point, Antimage with a Claymore and Ring of Health. He can control the creep equilibrium. Doesn't matter. The cogs at this point, I feel, is a bit redundant.
Yeah, I mean, the thing...
He's taking the creep wave here. His support's pull. He just tanks the creep wave. He can easily last it under the tower because of the Claymore. He's Coiling Blade as well, so there's no problems with him. There's no point really doing this cogs in. Here we go. Rotate mid.
Malk has arrived in mid. Yes. Ooh. Thank goodness.
10 XP per minute.
250% of his XP per minute, now rising to 300%. His XP is climbing so quickly. The only problem is like two shockwaves and he's done.
He's out of control. Someone better start ganking him soon. This 21 XP per minute. Yikes.
This is a big downside, honestly. Not being able to contribute with the clockwork at all. Surely the clockwork is part of their plan to actually win this game, but I like the rotation to mid, honestly, because they did get the advantage over that Magnus, which means he has to play it a little safer.
All right, so I think the big thing we can question here, we haven't really talked about it all, it's Antimage versus Spectre. Is there sort of a clear favorite as far as strategically who's going to be better off as far as the hard carries go?
I don't think so, and also the Midas throws a wrench into it. Of course, Spectre for a long time regarded as the hard carry's hard carry, basically. Honestly, we'll sort of see how the matchup develops, because right now both carries sort of just going total farm.
Yeah.
I actually think early on in EG gank, Spectre will be very, very effective. I think Tony Montana, for instance, is guaranteed dead.
Tony Montana dead. There was a Lasso into the silence from the Puck, and Puck Geo is actually going for Max Waning Rift before getting the Illusionary Orb, so the extra silence duration's there, and we'll see a push on mid lane, and another kill going the way of EG. They're now up 3-0, and this is just very refined play. They're not giving anything to Aurochs. It's 3 kills to nothing. Sure, Malk's level... Well, he's level 3 now, but he was level 1 for the longest time, but it doesn't really matter. They weren't giving up a single kill with him. They weren't giving up any space whatsoever. It was just Antimage getting free farm, but they were okay with that because Spectre was getting the same treatment at top.
Right, the exact point at which they wanted to break Aurochs' aggression. The fact that Magnus has all 3 of their deaths, that Tony Montana isn't able to get around the map and generate opportunities, means that they can't possibly kill Demon. I mean, is Jakiro Darkseer going to kill Demon? Probably not. And so they targeted the one part of Aurochs' strategy that would allow them to play aggressively, which I think is very smart. Just to return to the Spectre anti-mage question really quick, I think actually the way this is panning out, Demon is going to have the advantage at most stages. There's going to be a period at which anti-mage is farming very quickly and does well, but early on, I actually favor Demon because he can ultimate, and just the fact that he went hard Desolate, like he's already maxed out Desolate and only has just the one Dispersion, means that he might as well just not TP over. Just his ultimate enough will be doing pretty dramatic damage to whoever EG are focusing.
I think Antimage is going to be playing a very different strategic game. He's going to be focused a lot more on split pushing this game, because Oryx are behind. He's got his Battlefree, 11-minute Battlefree, actually pretty damn nice. He's sure
pretty
he's
good.
Gone completely naked Battlefree, but he's going to get a big creep stack here, so he's going to get his treads up pretty nice and fast. Jakiro going to help him out, take this up, and well,
I thought D-Boss was actually going for creep steals there.
Nice. He's gonna tank it. Someone's gonna tank it. Those shockwaves hurt too.
It's true.
125 damage, and Rockets actually scout things out. Salve is there. Uh-oh. Demon wants
really
in.
Bad.
Demon's gonna come in. Dead Jakiro. One dead. Can they get more? I don't think they'll get any more, but that was a... They got caught out.
Actually, Tossie, if Fear blinks onto him...
We could see it. Blink and a flame break. It's gonna maybe come here. Tossie quite low, not going to do
anything. All he needs is Flame Break, yeah.
Blinking it, not forget Flame Break. He goes for a Lasso. Fear needs to be careful, he's out of mana, and Antimage does have a mana void here. Won't do enough damage to kill him all.
Oh.
But Mags arrive. RP only catches Demon. Ooh.
No mana.
Wanted to catch the Batrider, but they get Demon anyway, so they bring down Spectre, and Antimage actually gets the kill, so big pickups going the way of, well, big pickup going the way of Aurochs.
Yeah. Could have been worse, could have been better. They did. Demon actually did score a kill, by the way, just with Spectral daggering Tossie. I think Tossie felt so happy that he defensive disrupted his way out of the Batrider, and he was like, I'm safe. And then that, like, black thing across the ground just starts crawling towards him, and he goes, oh, no. Sort of like a Final Destination film, basically.
Well, this is... I think that's actually a good fight for Oryx. They get Antmage up to level 10, so he's actually caught up to Spectre now with that kill on him. They're both sitting on level 10, and that's something which the Midas was giving Demon a bit of an edge with. Demon is...
Sure.
It looks like rushing a Radiance. It seems, I guess, sort of your old school way of playing Spectre. You go, well, it was like the Vanguard Radiance days. We're not seeing a Vanguard on him, but...
Radiance?
I'm guessing with all this gold he's stocked up, if you wanted to go Diffusal, you buy some pieces. If you want to get a Drums, buy some pieces. When you get Manta, buy your Yasha. It's,
sure,
it just
sure.
seems like we're seeing a Radiance rush.
I think you're right. I wonder about this Radiance a little bit, Gods. Of course, it is the very traditional Spectre build. You used to see them always go Radiance. Is it the right choice for this? I mean, I guess they have some squishy targets. There's the Jakiro, the Shadow Demon. It will be a very early Radiance when he does hit it. So those are the plus factors. Actually, I guess since Demon's strat is mainly just to pop ultimate and just win fights with the Desolate, the Radiance will help with that. Now that the illusions are beefier and can chase you, it's a little better just to have that Radiance to deal AoE damage, I guess.
It'll stop the Mag Blink as well, which is sort of a nice little perk, but I think all in all, it's an alright item choice, but it's gonna... It's EG playing very safe this game. They're gonna be looking to farm for late game. They're not looking to get super aggressive. Maybe they can take some teamfights with a Radiance on Demon. He's still got 900 HP, but as you saw last fight, if he gets caught by a disable and some follow-up damage, he will go down pretty damn fast.
Oh yeah, no doubt about it. Man. They also know Aurox's game plan. It's not subtle in any way, shape, or form. It's get the anti-mage to the point where he's sufficiently ahead of the Spectre that we can just safely split push with him and then win team fights on the back of like a big mana void or something.
There's a lot of stacking going on for this anti-mage too.
Yeah, exactly. So the question is really about control of the jungle. EG has better vision, and once they get this tier 1 tower, which I'm not sure Aurox can defend, they can start piercing into this jungle. As long as Aurox control this area, I think they're in good shape because the Anti-Mage is going to probably out-farm Demon even with the Midas. But if they start losing control over this jungle, Anti-Mage will not be able to find safe areas to farm.
Yeah, Anti-Mage is a slight edge at the moment with that 140 unit kills. He's actually got incredible unit kills right now. Demon's doing not bad. Fear's actually scouting around the bottom lane. They're going for this T1 tower, though, hoping to get a pick off as well, but Oryx doing the smart thing and just not taking the fight. They're not interested at all. Mags at mid still trying to farm off his Blink Dagger, trying to go for a bit of a counter push. Fear TP's in, and, well, Mag just a couple hundred gold away from a Blink Dagger. Also, level 11, very close. So we'll see a level 2 RP coming into play.
I like that Tony Montana has played a lot safer. He did have a very tough early game, especially compared to the last game where he was 5-1, I think, at this time. Now he's 1-3, but he's playing safe, getting those levels in RP. RP's a great spell at level 6, but honestly, it dramatically upgrades to 11 and 16. Mag's a hero that you really do want and need to hit his levels. After a certain point, level 6, the original RP just won't cut it, and you need to get it up. So it's smart that they are letting him have some of Anti-Mage's jungle, so that's smart.
I like this, and as other stuff I like going on, Malk, despite the start he had, he is level 7 in a second and has a mech, and we're 16 minutes in. Like, that's a good offlane player. If you can be level 1 at, like, what, 10 minutes in, and then suddenly level 7, mech up, he can offer a lot to his team right now.
Yeah, he has bettered B-Diz and both Dubas and who's Tossie on Aurox in terms of XPM, just because he's managed to find farm wherever there's just a little bit of space for him to level up.
Well, we're going to see a rotation now from EG. They've got a couple smoked up there looking for Antimates. Blink Silence is there. Once the Silence hits, he's dead. Lasso to follow things up to ensure the kill. Even Demon came in for that one. And I guess they go for a tier 2 bottom, but they're actually going to... Oh, Beatus at top. The skewer not going to land. Beatus is left on his own here. They should be going for this kill. I'm surprised they're not actually diving Beatus. Beatus blocks himself in with a Plague Ward, but with so many heroes committing bottom, I felt like that was should be an easy pickoff.
Maybe they're afraid of them, because EG didn't have to TP for this.
Yeah.
They didn't have to TP to get the AM kill, so they're afraid that if they dive, they'll all TP on top of them. I like this, actually. It takes discipline to not bite the Beatus. Like, you gotta sometimes just let him go and not go for him. The one thing is, I talked about control of the jungle gods, and that's what EG, I think they realize that this is the main strategic objective of the map. Look how much of their wards, basically 75% of their wards are committed to this jungle. like covering every possible angle that Anti-Mage can enter or exit these camps. And Fear, literally just standing here, is going to stack this jungle and clear it out just so that Anti-Mage can't come in and seize it.
Yeah, this is a really nice play coming up from EG. Fear stacks it, we'll clear it next, and Oryx, this is, they've got to really buckle down and just sort of play very safe defensive, pick their fights wisely, which is basically when Mag can get a good RP and you can see some good Jakiro or Darkseer follow-up. It's a great team fight Oryx have, but EG's play around it is just to go for pick-off after pick-off around the map. They're not going to go for a big 5-on-5 head-on fight.
Yeah, I think Oryx are actually playing pretty well. The score might not reflect it, but I do enjoy the disciplined play from them. A lot of times, and maybe in our last game you sort of see that, newer teams, or teams that don't have as much experience, can have some great individual play, but usually the deficit comes in the fact that, you know, they don't quite make good strategic decisions as a team. And in both games from Oryx, it's actually not that we've seen them make huge individual plays, but that they've had a plan and had the discipline to stick to it. And they're doing that in this game, even if it's not going to be quite enough to overwhelm the fact that just pound for pound EG might be stronger right now. What you want to see from teams like this is that they sort of have that strategic cohesiveness, and I think they absolutely do.
Yeah, Oryx, every little move around the map, we can see some purpose to. There's been a lot of stacking coming out of the supports, and as a result, despite the 6-1 kill lead for EG, it's 2k XP, 2k gold about, and that's very, very small at this point in the game. Anti-Mage has kept up pretty well, and Spectre does have a completed Radiance here, but you feel Oryx, they've still got a lot to offer, especially considering any team when you've got Mag Darkseer in a team fight. That far outshines what EG have, and, well, they're going to try to use that. They're going to group up as five and just grab themselves a T1 tower here, uncontested.
Sure. And it's not just Mag Darkseer. Anti-Mage, the Mana Void, is no slouch on that big RP stack as well, because, of course, if you hit something like Puck, once J.O. adds a few more int items, like if he gets a Scythe of Vice or something, a big Mana Void on him will probably wipe the entire team if they're stuck in that, except for, obviously, for Demon.
Well, both teams going for pushes. EG want the tier 2 mid, Anti-Mage is going for the tier 2 top, and he may well get this. He got left there with an Empower. And if he can just trade tier 2 towers here, that means, well, Oryx, they get a T1 and a tier 2. Darkseer just goes flying in, and EG are scared to take this engagement. They're going to get the tier 2 bottom, though. So there's your other little trade-off. Demon gets himself some more gold. Tier 2 at top still actually standing, so maybe EG can even defend it.
It's an interesting choice that Seema made. He cut the creeps just for creep farm. I think he felt he just doesn't quite have enough damage to bring down this tower by himself, so he doesn't really want to commit too hard to it.
Afraid of also, I imagine, TP's in, because a blink...
Definitely.
When you haven't got your mat style up, you can get silenced by Puck and brought down with a blink silence, or even a blink lasso from Batrider. There's a lot that can cause him issues here, so...
Right. And once you're lassoed, I mean, Spectre will ultimate, and just the Desolate plus Radiance will actually do a lot.
Oh, he's so close to this mag. If you just go for... He doesn't have his force up here. That's the problem.
He's going to go.
He catches Tony Montana. They get the vision defensive disruption will help keep Tony Montana alive. Skewered to the high ground. Puck goes in with a coil. Looks like Shadow Demon will be the one taking a fall, as well as potentially Darkseer. Can he get the Wall of Replicator off just in time? He wants an Illusion Inspected with that Radiance damage, but he's not getting it just yet. There's an RP. Not a good one. Beat his drops, but not the RP they were looking for.
I actually think that was a bit of a miscommunication, gods. They had a good defensive disruption, and Shadow Demon, Tossy, and Ka thought that they actually had the fight, so they go down while Magnus skewers back up. There was absolutely... And he skewered, like, he didn't skewer anybody. That was purely an escape skewer. So Tony Montana thought that they were going to play defensively, whereas I think Dubas and Tossy and Ka thought that they were going to flip it around on EG. And consequently, I think you saw that they could have actually maybe taken the fight if everyone was on the same page, but just the sort of confused and slightly half-assed approach led to them not getting as much from it as they
could
have.
I think it's okay for Oryx. It's a 2-for-2 trade. Anti-Mate's got both the kills. He's now got himself a Mantis style. It wasn't a perfect team fight. It wasn't a good RP, but end of the day, the trade-off they got was not all too bad. It could have been better, but they'll be perfectly happy with it.
I agree with you, Gots. I think it was good. It's just the distance between getting a good trade and like a fantastic trade when you're behind is substantial.
Oh, yeah. If they go aggressive right off the back and catch EG by surprise, hit 2 or 3 in the RP, it's completely different.
Exactly. I mean, the thing is, the defensive disruption was so good. Like, that was a world-class disrupt because it meant that Magnus couldn't be waning rifted, and he essentially had a free RP on 2. What he traded that for was later an RP on just Beatiz, which is meh.
No, it was definitely not worth it. We'll see. Well, split push continuing from Oryx, and I think this is a good decision here. It's so hard for EG to push. Sure, you can have Spectre defending and then looking to sort of ult into the fight, but He can't even really hold his own 1v1 against someone like an Antimage if it's Antimage pushing. But right now, Dark's here top, Demon going to TP in, and Demon with 3.6k God, he needs to start tanking up, looking at either a Heart of Tarrasque or something like a Manta style.
I would love Heart. I mean, it synchronizes with the Radiance, because Radiance, it's not an enormous amount of DPS just in terms of it adding to your melee, even though it's got a good... Oh, he actually goes Diffusal, so no, Demon playing very aggressively indeed. This will make his ultimate actually extremely powerful, because those are going to be illusions that that Mana Drain, as well as illusions that have the Radiance on them, and that's going to be a ton of damage wherever Aurochs are.
You know who else loves illusions, though? Both Shadow Demon and Darkseid can make Spectre illusions, so they're going to get the Radiance, they're going to get the Mana Burn.
But it's the same with Hard,
yeah,
really.
They get the HP. It'll be tanky. But there's a certain duration on the Shadow Demon illusions anyway, so if they're super tanky, you just ignore them for the 6 seconds or whatever it is. It's level 1 disruption, so 5 seconds, yeah.
Huge beat his forest here on this Roche. They're going to get this without Demon's help.
Yeah, it looks like Demon going to come on in, although he's not really needed. And Oryx, whether they know or don't, you can't really... They probably do suspect something like this could be happening.
Oh, sure.
They're actually
going to
get some map control over in their own jungle here, do some dewarding and get some vision up. So I like this from the Jakiran. I think they probably know, but they're quite happy to give it up.
I think it's actually more important for them. This might be a little counterintuitive, but I think it's at least as important for them to have some vision and control over this sort of bottom area than it is to try to contest this Rosh, because getting this vision is actually risk-free, basically, while the other team is working on Roshan, and they move to a position where they're much more comfortable placing people in this sort of jungle area without having them immediately ganked.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, from here on out, it looks like, I mean, we've had a pretty low kill, unfortunately. Strategic chess-like game here, but the Antimage Spectre both getting pretty big. Antimage leading the way in terms of net worth. He's up by about 1,200-1,300 bits. EG overall with a 2k lead, but I feel like this net worth we're seeing on, well, Puck, we're looking at a side of the Vice coming later, it doesn't really translate into a 2k lead for EG, because Mag just has a blink, and that's all you need. Puck with an ultimate orb isn't really adding a whole lot to EG. Maybe once you get the side of the Vise up, it translates into a lead, but right now, EG do not have a lead. If they can kill Antimage, they might. Antimage actually caught at mid lane. He's tanky, he's hard to bring down, and there's an Ice Path. Once again, Dubas, right place, right time, Macropie to follow things up. Spectre going to try Dagger's way in. Defensive disruption again from Tossie. Keeps Antimage alive. There's your blink out. Wall from the Darkseid. Mag RP, they bring down feeders. Not the best RP. Antimage does eventually die, and this Venom ultimate is actually doing some work. Feeders. Man.
He's so good,
take
though,
a bite
man.
Of the beaters, and, well, it hurts.
Exactly.
He does not go down well.
It's a poisoned apple, man. It's a poisoned apple.
Antimage almost brings down Fear here with the ulti, but it doesn't do enough damage, and he changes target onto some creeps, and looks like Spectre actually took out the Darks here on the sidelines. Antimage forced to blink away, and that fight did not go well for Aurex.
Actually, Demon is a little bit vulnerable here. If he gets Mana Voided... Oh, or he just used Mana Void, too.
He used it on the back. He was looking for Fear. Fear got down to about maybe 300 HP, but it just wasn't enough. And EG, well, good fight for them. It was... They never looked like they were going to lose that fight. It was just a very scrappy fight, the way they played it. And that favors them, because it's the big wombo combo team fight of a Mag, Darkseid, Jakiro, which they don't want to be fighting into. So they played that fight perfectly.
Absolutely. They didn't kill Seema, which is the one thing maybe they wanted that they didn't get. But a pretty good fight. And the RP,
they
honestly,
did kill him.
They
killed him
RP,
and he bought back, actually.
Oh, yeah, you're right. So I totally forgot. That's actually... Yeah. No, that's huge. They got exactly what they wanted then. And the RPs, that's what's lacking from this game compared to the last Aurochs game, where Tony Montana was just really dominant. He's been a very, very quiet Magnus.
Yeah, he's just not been able to sort of find those openings. It's been one-man RPs. Here and there, EG's positioning in these team fights has been the main reason that's caused that. You have just Spectre, who's sort of in. Spectre can just go off on his own, do whatever he wants in a team fight. Clockwork can be mobile, going in and out. Same for the Puck, same for the Batrider. Both those heroes with blink daggers. You got a four staff on the Batrider. And Beat as well. He's dying in these fights, but he's dying for the greater good.
Yeah, I mean, they're using him as a human shield, basically, which is not great, and I'm pretty sure it's against the Geneva Conventions. But in the fields of Dota, it's totally fine. And this is hardly the first time that Beatus has ended up being used as a human shield for EG.
Yeah, it's a bit of a common EG tactic, especially with that Venomancer. I feel like EG have something against Venomancer, man. I don't know what it is.
I mean, the thing about Venno, in that time they absolutely got nothing off, because maybe if you get Venno before he ults, And if they actually had gotten Beatas before he ulted, at least they could have kept chasing EG around the map. But because Beatas actually got the ultimate off, you ended up seeing like four Aurochs heroes super low, just sort of limping away from the fight before it even really got started for them.
Yeah, it really doesn't help. And
you see Heart Rush both on Anti-Mage and on Demon, by the way.
I think it's the right choice for both of them. Anti-Mage just needs the raw HP to survive. There's not a whole lot of physical damage to out-carry it. So I think it definitely makes sense on Anti-Mage. And for Spectre, whether it's a Heart or a Manta style, I think either way is pretty solid choice. And we'll see the Heart coming up on Demon pretty soon. I think that if Seyma had the Reaver in that last fight, he would have survived. But it's not that he could have survived. He would have survived.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, Aurochs, they're still just not quite finding the perfect confluence of factors in the team fight. And I always sort of, this is something I actually kind of harp on. If you feel like you have an uphill battle already, you have to think about, I feel, lowering the margin of error for your draft. Like, make sure that the execution is something that you feel completely up to if you're already facing a hard fight. And so the combo that they need, like the perfect RP with a great ice path and a vacuum and stuff, is one that actually has a pretty narrow margin of error. Obviously, these players all know how to play their heroes, but it's the added pressure of this extremely mobile EG team that's hard to catch out, and you're just setting yourself such a difficult task, fundamentally speaking, in each of these fights.
Yeah, and EG, well, they're going to start steamrolling through this top lane, and they've got this mobility, which they're using just so well. Fear looking around on the sidelines, he may pop another Firefly in 2 seconds and go searching for a pickoff. Does just that. Well, he's not really searching just yet. He may look to five. Yeah, he's going to fly down. Can he actually catch anyone is the question. Radiance looks like he's being pinged. The question is, I don't know if it was maybe EG pinging him.
I think it was Aurochs, actually. Yeah, I think it was Shadow Demon that pinged.
They backed off completely.
Yeah. Smart, honestly. They can't defend this tier 2.
There is Anti-Mage at bottom lane. He's actually just looking for a tier 1. Demon's there. He can always use his ultimate Haunt and Reality in, but actually, Seymour goes on him. He's got no mana now, Demon. Huh? He's got mana for a Haunt and a Reality, but he can't use Dagger after it, and now he's got no mana. He's not coming to this fight, Spectre.
Actually,
he's winning this battle against Anti-Mage.
I actually think AM could have maybe peeled off at least the Aegis there. He didn't need to necessarily. And while the Aegis was down, he could have gotten the tower. I think these were actually slightly questionable decisions. He could have either been safer and not fought Demon at all, or more dangerous and tried to kill him.
I think he would have lost that fight. Desolate hurt. That's true. Pure damage, I want to say.
It is pure
damage. And 65 pure damage a hit, I looked like Anti-Mage was losing that clash. And you got Dispersion on top of it. It would have been close with the Mana Void, but I think Spectre would have lived on maybe about 400 HP.
He actually you're actually right, because I think he could have Mana Voided and he might have died from his own Mana Void damage.
Well, Spectre gets the tower. I think it's okay just forcing a deny anyways at this point. Maybe you lose, what, 500-600 gold, but more importantly, you get your team some map control. EG
you
can't TP to that tower anymore, and Demon gonna blow away his Aegis on some Ancients here because they time Roshan and, well,
about 40 seconds. They're not going to have a fight in 40 seconds, so yeah, you're right. There's no point in him not just staying farming the Ancients. Peeling off would waste a lot of time.
Yep, so EG, they settled down, and the big difference is here to me. Looking at the two teams' net worth, Anti-Mage and Spectre, pretty much dead even. Puck and Mag, pretty much even. Darkseer's pretty much even with the Batrider, but that's clockwork. Essentially, EG have two, three
Fear's
position heroes.
Fear's going in.
Yeah, Fear's found the pick off. It's on Tony, and he's left to hang and dry. Or is it? Jakura's going to go in the Macro Pie. He's already thrown the Ice Path. Mal going to go hooking in, followed up by a Cult
Nice. Tip.
Really great initiation. Mag, though, he's found the Skewer. RP on a Demon as well. Can they bring down Demon? They need some Anti-Mage DPS. Where is Anti-Mage? He's brought down one. It's Venomancer once again. He brings down the Beaters, but it's at the cost of his whole entire team. Illusion Army from the Darkseer. Can this do enough damage? They've got the Spectre Illusion, but not for much longer. They even have an Anti-Mage Illusion? What? Was that
a Shadow Demon?
Okay, Shadow Demon. Okay.
Or wait, no. Actually, how do they have an Anti-Mage?
No, it looked like it was a Darkseer Anti-Mage.
Oh, it's Manta. It's Manta.
Okay, that makes a lot more sense. Now we're on the same page.
Oh no.
Anti-Mage silence up. He's looking for Demon here. Demon's poking around in the trees. Pops Manta once again, and well, it looks like Anti-Mage just can't finish off any of these kills.
Actually, excellent defensive play from Jao and Fear there. Flame breaking away the illusions from chasing Demon, and then waning rifting the Anti-Mage immediately when he tries to jump on Demon. That was actually really, really good. That's very good support protecting like the main carry play there.
Yeah,
really disciplined.
I I feel like EG don't really have a good answer to the Antimates, but they have enough answers to the rest of their team that these they're quickly killing everyone else, and then they turn their attention to Antimage and like, well, if we have enough numbers, we can kill them. If not, we just back off, and then we take our 2-for-4. Maybe they'd take a 2-for-4 trade. They lost Venomancer as well as, I think, Clockwork in that last fight for 4 kills, and they're quite happy with that.
I believe, yeah, I think the apropos line is Skeleton King when he Aegis is up and there are no heroes in range. He just goes, guys! And that's kind of the position that Seema's finding himself in here. The rest of his team is kind of low level and easy to pick off, and here come more pickoffs. Actually, a good skewer there.
Yeah, Shadow Demon Disruption and Walt Fiat.
Unfortunately.
It looks like Tossi is dead regardless, and it will be the case. Demon picks himself up another kill. Demon now. Well, Heart's finished. Minus is still there. Diffusal Blade, Radiance. He's probably going to be looking at level 2 Diffusal Blade once he runs out of charge. He's going to TP top and Seema. He's going to give up another Tower Deny. He's actually going to once again try and fight this. He's got some illusions there, so we're not seeing the Desolate damage come into play just yet. And there's also backup in the form of the Darkseer. Haven't seen a lot from this Darkseer. That's one hero I feel like should have had a bit more of an impact this game.
I mean, Darkseer and Magnus, frankly. Yeah. Okay, Magnus had a hard time, but then that means that the Darkseer should have been relatively free. You mentioned, I mean, Darkseer was 5 when Melk was rocking his big 4 XP per minute, and who's actually made the bigger impact on this game? You could at this point argue after that last fantastic hookshot that Melk has had a bigger impact despite his start.
Look, Melk has been involved in 10 of these kills.
Mm-hmm.
He's had this mech in these team fights, and for Darkseer has also had a mech in his team fights, which has helped out from time to time.
Sure.
But I feel like Malk, yeah, I agree, has had a much bigger impact overall. Fear continuing his impact on the game. He's got himself a gem, doing some dewarding on the higher ground, and just if EG get map control right now, they can just basically make it so that the only way Oryx can play is with Antimage split pushing, and just only Antimage can be on the map, and then the 4 supports, well, the 4 non-Antimage heroes have to be either sitting behind him or off smoke ganking, leaving Antimage on his own. There's really,
I don't even know that if they try for a smoke gank, they'll get
they
one.
They have no damage. I feel like, Darkseer Mag, they're great team fights, but there's no secondary source of damage apart from Antimage. Yeah.
It's pretty much the Antimage show, and so they need to make that work. Now, Gods, I guess if you were playing in this game and you were on Aurox, or you were their team captain, what should Antimage actually do? Like, I know he needs to split push. Does BKB help with that, or should he go another build? Or?
I think it's just all about the butterfly. We're actually going to see him pick off Demon. That's what you want to do if you're Antimage.
Ooh.
Look at the radiance and how much damage. You need a Pipe. Pipe is actually really good against Spectre here, but we're going to see Spectre buy back reality in here. Fears lassoed one, but there's another defensive disruption. The problem is there's no RP. There's a wall of replicate. They get the Spectre illusion. Can it do some damage? Demon's fighting his own illusion. Not for much longer. There we go. The illusion does go down. And Spectre, triple kill going to his name. I mean, not great for Aurochs, but I think they're killing the Spectre there, getting the kill. Antimage gets out. Antimage on 6k gold now, so he can look towards his butterfly, I imagine. Back to your point, I think you go butterfly here. Having the evasion, it's not so much about the evasion, but it's just sort of the best item for when you're split pushing and just pushing out lanes fast.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. I think that's probably the best thing that he can build. Because, yeah, the key at this point is split push. You have to distract EG's attention somehow so they don't just high ground you, but it's a very, very tall order, and they're just plowing people into the sort of Spectre meat grinder here. Like, even, I think you and I both gasped when we saw that Mana Void on the Anti-Mage, and it took everybody on Radiant to half health, and it's like, that's not how that ability's supposed to work.
No, the funny thing is that, well, something that people don't realize, Pipe is actually a decent, well, not counter, but a decent way of dealing with Spectre, because it blocks all of that dispersion damage. It's all magic damage, so having a Pipe will help a lot against that Spectre if you're trying to focus him down, because it gets split evenly, so Pipe is the perfect way, because, well, you're splitting the damage, it's about 400 each.
This is bad. Seema,
I don't think they can actually, can they kill him off?
Yes. Oh, no, not with Manta.
Oh, with a Hex they can. Who's got a Hex? It must be Jo. Well-timed Hex here, but they still can't kill him off. He's going to blink out anyways. Dream Coil.
I don't know.
We'll do some damage. Hookshot from Malk, I think, gets blocked by his teammates. There's another blink. This heart, it makes him too damn tanky.
Wow. He blinks the fact that he got to low ground. How'd he get to low ground is my question.
And Darkseer may take the fall. He is looking to TP out. There's nothing
he's
to
okay.
stop it. Cog's too late.
It wasn't even in this position.
This is kind of what we're looking at, where EG can't deal with Antimates. A Hex, a Lasso. They had a full Lasso duration, a full Hex duration. They couldn't kill him.
Dream Coil, too.
Yeah.
He actually popped pretty much every relevant ult, even Hookshot. Actually, maybe if Hookshot had landed.
Miss. It's an extra, like, 100 damage, maybe, if that? It's less than 100 damage, I think, coming out of
Disable.
Yeah. His Blink was on cooldown anyways after.
That's true. That's a good call.
He's got to wait for Blink to come back. So it's they just don't have the actual damage on these heroes. Mm-hmm. Spectre's a carry hero, but like you probably call her a hard carry, but not really a hard carry who can fight Anti-Mage. And well, she's who can kill Anti-Mage. Yeah, it's a tanking style hard carry, kind of like a Bristleback in ways, although you do more damage than a Bristleback.
Yeah. But
it's Anti-Mage who just at this point is getting pretty unkillable. Butterflies up, 2k gold. So he's if they kill him there though, it's probably GG because he didn't have buyback.
Yeah. But luckily, I mean, and that makes EG have to wait because obviously all of their ults now need to refresh. They are back up now. The question is really.
Spectre has no buyback.
Not can Orox avoid losing, but can they win? Well, they can avoid losing.
If
for
they
a
kill
while.
Spectre here, they've got themselves a nice little opening.
EG are
like
massing up though.
They don't want to take the risk. Yeah. Oh man.
There's the lasso.
It's Anthony.
We're
gonna
try again.
I don't see this working. Well, can they prove me wrong? Seyma, he doesn't even get down to half HP. Now he's half HP. The silence comes afterwards. This silence actually may be what secures his death. The Waning Rift. It gets the kill, and Anti-Mage immediate buyback. Darkseer can get caught out as well, and...
Actually...
That's what they didn't have last time, the Waning Rift.
Yeah, that was... That silence lasted, it seemed like, for ages. Like, every moment that silence ticked down, and the Anti-Mage was just losing HP, and losing HP, and losing HP. It actually felt way longer than 3 seconds, frankly.
I think last time he got out of it with the Mantis Cell. This time, didn't have Mantis Cell up, or he popped it and the silence came afterwards.
He popped it earlier, yeah.
So
that was good, actually. Good timing for EG to wait until the Manta before doing the Waning Rift, because that's the big difference. Silence is always good against Anti-Mage.
Yeah, so we'll see EG now go straight down the mid lane. No buyback on Anti-Mage. They're feeling pretty confident, and they've still got this Aegis on Spectre for, well, a good 3-4 minutes. So, hey, let's look for Raxes, EG. They've got Lasso up in 5 seconds. I imagine they'll try to get a pick up before they look to go high ground.
Definitely. They actually... Aghanim's is almost up on Melk as well, and this is not nothing, because it gives them every 12 seconds, they can try to just get the perfect initiation, and they can use fear to counter the counter initiation, because they can initiate on like a support, because Aurochs can't afford to lose a support for their turtle, and then when Aurochs respond to them hooking the support, they can lasso whoever comes into hell.
Well, there was a smoke actually from AG. Oh, Blink Lasso doesn't find anyone. Demon's trying to follow it up, Anti-Mage, well, he's going to actually fight Spectre. Does quite a bit of damage. Dishes more than he takes, and now he's hexed up once again. Can they bring him down? This time, defensive disruption is there. Ice Bath on Demon. Demon, you gotta be careful. He's got Aegis.
He's Soul Catcher.
How much longer? And he's taking a lot of damage with that Soul Catcher. Mana Void, but just for an Aegis, I don't know if that's worth it.
It's okay. They would have liked to do it on an RP stack, but again, that's so hard to pull off. Like, if you don't have to, you don't want to count on everything going perfectly. You want to count on, like, the average case. So it's good enough for them to pick off an Aegis, as long as they don't spend RP, Illusionary Wall, or Macropyre.
Yeah, there's still a couple minutes left on an Aegis, so it wasn't as if the Aegis was just about to expire. And hey, they force EG back. EG do still have Lasso, so they may look to hang around, try find the pick off, but for the time being, well, Aurochs, they buy themselves some time. Anti-Mage, I wonder what he goes now, and maybe we see a BKB now.
Lincoln's IMO. Why not?
Yeah. I don't think...
Lasso, Hookshot, both go through a BKB, and they're what EG is using to initiate on you. And heck, no joke either. I don't know.
Cancels it? Spectral Dagger maybe cancelled Lincoln? I'm not sure how that works. If you click
on
the hero.
On cast or on landing? That's the big thing. I don't actually know.
I don't know how Spectral Dagger would work with Lincolns. Because you can actually click a hero and target them with it. We'll see a pick-off, though. Mid lane. Jakira picked off by Puck and Lasso onto Shadow Demon. They get both supports immediately and Darkseer as well. That is disaster.
Yeah.
For Aurochs. I mean...
They lacked a little bit of patience.
These squishy heroes, they're important for defending. Disruptions are so important at this stage in the game. Darkseer, he's Darkseer. And Jakira, we've seen some great Ice Path. Macropyre, Dubas had a great tournament so far here in WePlay, but that was not his finest moments.
No. They just ran out of patience a little bit. They went to the low ground, and yeah, I totally agree with you. They cannot turtle without these support staff, and none of them have buyback. I mean, you do have buyback on the Jakiro, and they're going to hang on to that if they can, although if he dies again without getting more gold, that's not going to happen either. So EG, if they get one more like that, they can sort of trivially high ground. It was a mistake for Aurochs, honestly. A pretty serious one.
Yeah, and EG, they keep on applying that pressure, even without the Aegis now, and we're seeing a lot of gold and item growth now, something which they didn't have earlier on, where it was very even when you looked at the sort of the top six farmers with three being on each side, not much separating them. But EG now starting to pull away a little bit. You got Puck with 3K gold. Be interesting to see what he looks to pick up. I wouldn't even mind seeing some DPS on this park. Grab an MKB, man. Ant-Mage has a butterfly. Get some MKB.
I would love Orchid, honestly. I think Orchid's still the right way to go.
Orchid's solid. You can Manta out of it. You can maybe see Ant-Mage going for a BKB, but it's going to be a solid choice, especially if you can time it after his Manta style.
Definitely. I would go for Orchid. But if you do like Puck and other int mids going DPS abilities gods, you should check out the VG game from this morning. Okay. I won't spoil it, but I
watch a lot of Mushi Queen of Pain and have seen some very interesting builds from him.
It was in that vein, in the vein of the Mushi Sing Sing auto attack quap.
Okay. Well, I'll have to check out that replay. I've seen the other two games with ZSMJ. Disgusting. I was looking for a more creative word, but I'm pretty happy with how that came out.
Disgusting. Wow, this is like when you saw Treant from LGD Int, and I was so sad, gods. But luckily, Empire later that day redeemed, in my opinion, the esteem of the noble Treant.
I don't hate this item. I hate this item in this game and in this scenario.
I agree.
It's so late. What's a slow going to do against an anti-mage? What's it going to do against a Darkseer who can surge? There's just no practical use for the Atos.
Yeah, I totally agree, because why would you slow people inside their base? They're already inside their base. Did you not want them to go in their base? Like,
oh, man.
I don't know. I think it's, I don't know if it's just like a mad pop-offs item. Maybe it'll go a second Atos, just to, like, tweak Dignitas or something. I don't know.
I don't know. Hey, Jayo's played fantastic. It's just his item.
Yeah, he has had a great game. Yeah. So, definitely.
Nothing against Jayo, but this item does not really add much to the team overall. But where the team is overall, they're leading. They've got themselves pretty much in a position where they can take the next Roshan. Look at taking... they have 43 minutes in. They still haven't looked at sort of going high ground for tier 3s yet, but they've got a maxed out Spectre just about. Uh-huh. And things are going very, very well. Fear as well getting a lot of farm. He's going to have a second Scyther Vise up. So once they have the second Cheap Stick up, then they can really deal with this Anti-Mage pretty well.
Definitely. That gives them the additional 3.5 seconds that they basically need to kill him. But, you know, I mean, an Orchid would have done the same thing. I feel like I'm wearing, like, a t-shirt that says, why not Orchid? But, oh, okay, so I was wondering what Shakira was making. He's actually moving towards Vlad's. And if he manages to build this is a big deal for Anti-Mage. It's armor, it's damage, it's lifesteal. It's a lot of what he wants.
Yeah, Anti-Mage, he's gone Basher, actually, so... No BKB! This is okay. I mean, it's just... I like the BKB here, just because of how much lockdown they have, and it gives you the guaranteed initiation. There's not much that goes through it apart from Lasso, but Basher's going to give him a lot more killing power. He's having some issues locking down heroes. Getting Bashers on Demon Spectre could really pay off here, so I'm okay with this.
It's a more gutsy play, definitely. It's more sort of, if we win big, and if we lose, well, we were losing anyway. So, I don't know. I don't hate it. At this point, earlier I was like, you want to sort of, when you're behind, you want to sort of try to sort of keep safe, play what you want. But they're starting to get behind to the extent that they have to take chances. Like, you can sort of play safe yourself into the grave. And even if they lose this game, that I don't think they were, like, expecting to convincingly win anyway, they're in good shape. So I think maybe they're taking a calculated risk. Obviously, Seema knows this is a risk, and he's baking that into, well, if I do manage to lock down Demon... We've won that fight, so I'm going to try to go for that.
Yeah, and at this point, maybe he even gets the full Abyssal Blade. Sure, you want to have buyback, but sometimes you just got to go big. He's just blinking and so aggressive. Mount? Is he actually going to chase further? No. Oh, he will.
Whoa.
He's not even getting an attack. It's ambitious because you're not even getting an attack rage. You're not even putting yourself in a position to get that first hit bash.
He might be trying to bait because they're four smoked behind him, but EG, I mean... The one thing I've really liked that I've seen from EG today in both games, with the exception of maybe one team fight, is that they're so patient. And even the best North American Dota teams like EG, like Liquid, like Dignitas, I sometimes feel like they just don't get that patience going, and they sort of overreach or try to go for kills that they shouldn't. And they're not doing that. They could have tried to go for the AM because there was a four-person smoke bait, and they didn't. To their credit, frankly.
No, they didn't, and they bought time for Roshan to respawn EG. Get themselves, well, in a bit of a contest here. This is not going to be given away for free by Oryx. Actually going with a pipe here. Mew on the sidelines. Beat is going a lot of damage, and it's clockwork as well as Beat is brought down. Antimage is doing the damage. He's gotten 3 kills already. Ooh, Nag up here on Demon. Demon goes down. Antimage, Oryx still in this game. Buybacks all over from EG. Ultra kill for Antimage, and Antimage is still doing work here. The bash has been the right play for him. Spectre going to turn things around with a triple kill of his own, and now we get into that 1v1 fight. Antimage versus Spectre, and Antimage, you're not winning this. Blinks out just in time. 30 HP, he's dead. Rampage goes both ways. Antimage gets Rampage, Spectre gets Rampage. Okay.
That just happened. Yeah, I feel very irresponsible for this, but when the heck did Magnus manage to finish his refresher? I saw Perseverance, and then I just sort of stopped paying attention. The problem is, the defusal from the rebought Spectre and the pre-existing Spectre illusion actually brought him down to where he couldn't double RP.
Oh, wow. And, hey, that defusal, when Antimage blinked away, he was still slowed. That's where that. Imagine if that was a Rod of Atos. You Atos him, he blinks away, he's still slowed, you kill him. That's the Atos magic.
That's the Atos.
If that had happened, I would have to eat my foot. That would be embarrassing. It wasn't an Atos, it was a defusal.
It was a defusal.
It could have been an Atos, and then that would have been embarrassing. That would have put me in an awkward position.
That would have put you in an awkward position, it's true. The question is, does Magnus... Oh, I wish Magnus was able to actually get into this fight. Antimage. Without him, it's tough.
Man up. You don't have buyback, but you're just going to go in.
No, he puts
away. No, they can't do it. They need Magnus. They need Magnus gods.
The plan is you blink on fear, you manta and abyssal him, and you just kill him, and then, well, fight one.
I don't know.
Fight in a good position. Fear with no buyback. If you're Antimage and you want to be fighting aggressively, you have to go on fear with an abyssal blade. And now we're going to see that happen. Blink out from Antimage. He's going to have to maybe re-engage. This is a nice counter gate coming out from Dax. He gets the wall of replica up in a pretty decent position here. He does get brought down eventually. Mag, there's your RP. Really nice. Spectre, though, has an Aegis. And Antimage will suit up, but this isn't going to do a whole lot to him. He's still got Abyssal Blade. He goes right in on Demon. Abyssal, Manta Illusion.
Soul Catcher.
Demon in all sorts of trouble. He gets away with the reality. He finds an escape room. It looks like he will get out of here. Antimage on the run. He's trying to chase down Angina here. He's getting diffused up once again. These purge charges coming out of Spectre.
No, that's Atos, buddy.
No, man. Atos was cooldown. I checked that. I'm calling bullshit on that. Antimage, get out of there. Don't get Atos. He blinks to the high ground. He's trapped, though. The Spectral Dagger. He goes down. Rod of Atos for the win. That's 16-second cooldown.
So Spectral Dagger is actually a bigger deal than Atos there for what it's worth. Because the ability to terrain walk up to the high ground was critical there. I think that's actually might be checkmate because it's 80 seconds with no AM. Oh. They put up a great last two fights, actually. Those were seriously exciting. And just they didn't quite get everything coming together at the same time. And that's the position they found themselves in at the end where they needed everything to happen. And maybe you were right, honestly, gods. Maybe they should have dived in with the Antimage a little earlier, tried to disrupt the Roshan. If there was no Aegis, Aurochs had that trivially.
I honestly think if he blinks in on Fear, Manta and Abyssals him and kills him off, then maybe they don't win the fight, but Fear can't buy back. Demon can't really do damage unless there's people locked in place, and he's getting people locked in place by Fear, but it was something where we have global vision. We see everything going on. He didn't even know where Fear was positioned, I don't think. He'd be blinking and blind, so...
They had no vision. The Ice Path actually kind of missed. Ice Path would give you vision to the low ground, but it didn't actually pierce the Roshan pit at any point in its path. So they had no idea who was in there, what they were doing, if they were just going to go in on a solo B-Diz, which would be the worst possible outcome.
Well, AJ looking to secure the game now. They get another Lasso kill this time. On the Dark Siege, that had been brought down as well. Inspector, Demon is just doing so much damage.
Mm-hmm.
Another four-man sweep, and there's your GG call. MKB 30, on Spectre.
Yeah, 37-14, but frankly, I don't think Aurochs availed themselves poorly here at all. I feel like there were definitely moments in that when EG was, even knowing that they were way ahead, sweating just a little bit because that Antimage was... He got a Rampage, and the only reason we're not talking more about it is because Demon also got a Rampage 5 seconds later.
Yeah, Antimage, well, he's stuck in his own fountain. He's dead. Wow. When you can die in your own fountain as an Antimage with heart butterfly, that's problematic.
The thing is, Demon at this point can sit in the fountain and repeatedly wipe Aurochs without attacking, just by virtue of the fountain dispersion.
Well, I'm not an Atos hater. I see some people saying that. I like this item, just in certain scenarios, not being one of them. But hey, it worked out pretty well. I'll give him credit for that. I was somewhat wrong here. AUI 2000 would be proud.
Let me defend you for a second, gods. Why not Orchid? Like, it would have done everything the same thing. Except instead of slowing him after he blinked, he just would not have blinked.
If you want the slow, why not Scotty?
Right.
There you go.
Oh, yeah. That's true. Puck Scotty is no joke, man.
It's all about the deep. But there we go. EG take it. They win Group H in the We Play Dota 2 League. They'll be back in phase two. We're going to have Aurochs up against Arctic Gaming to decide who gets second and third. Two teams we haven't seen verse each other yet. That should be an interesting game. Aurochs definitely sort of the more veteran team who you'd give the sort of the slight edge to, but Arctic a team who I feel capable of an upset there.
Yeah, no, honestly, I honestly think Aurochs definitely looking like the second best team in this group. I guess we'll find out in like 10 minutes because they're going to be facing up against, who would that be? Arctic?
Yep.
So, yeah, I mean, we'll find out. But honestly, they look pretty impressive. They definitely look like a solidly up-and-coming team that has strategies, executes them, and sometimes it's enough, sometimes it's not enough, but it's enough to make teams like EG, you know, have to take it slow and not just sort of walk over.
All right, well, thanks for joining me, Vikramont. You guys can follow Vikramont on Twitter. I think it's twitter.com/Vikramont. I'm Gods. You can follow me on Twitter. I'm twitter.com/BTSGods. We'll be back soon with our last game of today. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in. It's great to see this many people tuned in, even though there is the Starladder LAN finals going on. For those of you who don't know that, well, we've suddenly lost maybe a couple hundred viewers, but that's too bad. Starladder LAN finals is going on. I believe VP are playing against Fnatic. You can check it out over on Toby's stream as he's covering the Starladder LAN finals. But big thanks to everyone who's tuning in here, watching some good old-fashioned EG Dota. They're kind of back, and they're doing pretty well. Demon, 25-3-15 on that Spectre. A great showing for them, guys. Let's see if we can get one last great showing coming out of Aurochs or Arctic. That's going to be our last match of the day. Winner of that match advances. Loser goes home, so this is really where it's all at stake. This match here sure was your winner bracket final. It was a great performance from EG, but this next match is where it's basically one team advancing, one team going home. So, guys, thanks everyone for tuning in. I'm Gods, and we'll be back soon with more Dota 2 action.